Hello, Bea here, and welcome back to Biology. We're continuing our journey through biological diversity today with a look at the least understood domain and kingdom, Archaea. The word Archaea comes from the Greek word meaning ancient or primitive. It is thought that these organisms are directly descended from some of the oldest life on Earth, and yet they represent the newest addition to the taxonomic classification system, as they weren't discovered until late in the 1900s. Just like bacteria, the Archaea domain contains one kingdom, which is also called Archaea. Compared to the other two domains, scientists know relatively little about these creatures, as they tend to live in places that are difficult to study, and are known for being difficult to grow in the lab, so there still exists an air of mystery around these microscopic beings. We'll take a look today at what we do know about them. Before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to compare and contrast archaea and bacteria cells, and give examples of archaea both in extreme and familiar environments. Take a quick minute to review how we ended up with the Archaea domain. Hundreds of years ago, scientists initially grouped living things into two groups, plants and animals. Eventually, it became obvious that there were microscopic organisms that didn't fit into either of these kingdoms, so a third group was made for the tiniest of creatures. However, by the mid-1900s, it was becoming apparent to most scientists that simply putting all microscopic organisms into one group made little sense, as there were vast differences in the cellular structure and genetic makeup of these organisms. After all, a yeast cell and a bacterial cell have very little in common, other than the need to use a microscope to see them. So, bacteria were separated out as one kingdom, and the other microscopic organisms were largely placed into the protists and fungi kingdoms, giving rise to the five-kingdom system we saw in the introduction to this unit. But in the 1970s, biologist Carl Woese was studying the RNA of a particular type of bacteria at the University of Illinois and concluded that they were fundamentally and vastly different from any bacteria he had ever seen before. So different that he said they needed their own kingdom. It was quickly decided that even giving them their own kingdom was not enough. This represented such a large shift in what we knew about living things that an entirely new level was added to the taxonomic system, domains. And these unusual organisms, found by Woese, were given their own domain, completely separate from bacteria. What was so different about these microorganisms that justified such an overhaul of the whole taxonomic system? We'll look at that as we compare them to the other prokaryotic domain, bacteria. From a simple list of characteristics, bacteria and archaea would appear very similar. They are both single-celled prokaryotes, they both reproduce asexually by binary fission, their DNA is circular instead of linear, and they can both be either autotrophs or heterotrophs. So what makes them different enough to warrant being in entirely different domains? It's going to come down to the specific biochemistry that makes up the cells. One of the main differences can be found in the cell membrane. Remember from our cells unit that the cell membrane is a critical structure for the cell that controls which substances can enter and leave. We learned that the cell membrane is a lipid bilayer consisting of fatty acid molecules with phosphate heads. Sound familiar? Well, some archaea have a different structure and instead use only a monolayer as the membrane. It's thought by some scientists that this structure makes them more resilient in harsh environments, which they are often found living in. Further, the fatty acids that make up the membrane are ether lipids instead of the ester lipids that make up the membranes of bacteria. You'll learn more about what those words mean when you take chemistry, but for now, just know that it's like having one house made out of brick and one house made out of wood. Fundamentally different materials forming the structure of the houses, right? It's the same idea here. Remember that prokaryotic cells also have a cell wall outside the cell membrane. A major difference is found here as well. We learned in the previous lesson that bacteria cell walls contain peptidoglycan, which causes them to turn different colors in the process of Gram staining, depending on whether they have a thick or thin layer of peptidoglycan. Archaea do not have peptidoglycan at all in their cell walls, so Gram staining cannot be used to classify or separate them. With no peptidoglycan to absorb the dye, they would simply all show up as negative. A final difference appears in the process of DNA replication. We'll have to think back several units to remember what this process involved. The unzipping of the strands of DNA so that complementary base pairs could join each strand and make two identical strands from the original one strand. One key difference between prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells that we mentioned at the time was in the origins of replication. We said that prokaryotic cells have only one site where replication begins, and it then continues all the way around the circle of DNA. In eukaryotic cells, replication begins simultaneously in multiple locations. Well, it turns out that even though archaea are prokaryotic, their DNA replicates in a manner much more like eukaryotic cells, happening at several sites at once, and using the same replication enzymes as are found in eukaryotic cells. After much genetic testing, including technologies we have learned about, such as PCR and genome sequencing, it has been determined that archaea are more closely related to organisms in the eukarya domain, including you and me, than bacterial cells are. So, the common ancestor to all eukaryotes was likely an archaea, not a bacteria. For this reason, Carl Woese chose to redraw the tree of life like this, showing archaea and eukarya branching off more recently than bacteria and eukarya. We are descended from these strange, tiny organisms. Archaea are some of the least studied organisms, but if you look up information on them, one of the first common traits to show up is their ability to live in extreme environments. We're talking about places where we would generally assume no life would possibly be found. Thermophiles, such as Sulfolobus and Pyrococcus, thrive in hot springs and geysers, where the temperatures can be above the boiling point of water. Scientists think archaea living in these conditions may be very similar to some of the first life that evolved on Earth, as the conditions of early Earth would have been much like this. Time out for a quick vocabulary lesson. Do you remember what the suffix phyle means? Several units back, we talked about the hydrophilic heads and hydrophobic tails of the cell membrane. Phile means liking or friendly towards, while phobe means dislike or fear. Our hydrophilic heads liked water, but our hydrophobic tails disliked water. That's why they were on the inside of the membrane. We just talked about thermophiles. Can you guess what the two parts of that word translate to? Therm means heat, and we now know that phile means liking. So thermophiles like heat. Let's look at another type of philic archaea. In addition to being thermophiles, some archaea are acidophiles as well, meaning they like living in acidic conditions that would lead to instant death for most organisms. A species of Archaea named Armon was discovered here at a mine in California, where the pH is below 1.5. You'll learn more about the pH scale in chemistry, but that's about as acidic as an environment can get. Another category of Archaea, known as the halophiles, like very salty environments, like the Dead Sea, where the water is 10 times saltier than the ocean. Can you guess what the prefix halo means? Salt! These Archaea like salt. But what about the cold? We said Archaea could withstand intense heat. Is the opposite true? If you guessed yes, you're right! Psychrophiles such as Methanococcoides have been found in the Ace Lake in Antarctica, where the temperature rarely dips above freezing. Closer to home, Archaea can be found in almost any patch of soil. In fact, around 10% of the microorganisms in a scoop of soil will likely be Archaea. They are decomposers, just like many bacteria, and help recycle nutrients in the ecosystem. They can also be found right inside of you and me. Millions of Archaea cells, known as methanogens, live in the guts of animals and produce the methane gas that they release. And yep, I do mean that kind of gas. Ugh, does it stink in here? Other than the occasional unpleasant smell, Archaea are not generally thought to be dangerous to humans or other animals, and there are no currently known pathogens in this domain. However, their role in human health has not been adequately studied, and some scientists have found correlation between the presence of Archaea species and conditions such as gum disease and digestive complications. But not enough is known to be able to conclude that the Archaea are the root cause. As a whole, they seem remarkably harmless when compared to bacteria. As we went through the lesson today, we looked at how Archaea compare to organisms in the other prokaryotic domain, bacteria. We saw that of the prokaryotic domains, Archaea are likely our closest genetic cousins. And we saw some examples of the extreme environments that Archaea can live in, including right here in our own bodies. In the lesson PDF, you'll have a chance to further compare bacteria and Archaea, and explore the Archaean phyla. Next time, we'll move on to our first eukaryotic kingdom, protists. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. See you next time. Hey!